Just the presence of God makes you feel good, amen? And God's good to us, isn't he? And I'm excited about what God's doing. Last week we spoke about God's love, and we spoke about having, you know, if you, even though you prophesy and have all wisdom and all everything else, but you do not have love, you're like a clanging cymbal. And I'd like to just continue a little bit further this morning about God's love, because I think it's very, very important. Father, I ask you today that somehow, my God, you would break through our concepts, our mindsets that take us away from being able to embrace your awesome love. Lord, every lie that's ever been put inside of man, I ask you to remove it from our thinking today, that we can embrace and grab hold of the truth. For that we will give you all the praise, we'll give you all the glory. And everybody said, amen. Amen. I believe that God is an amazing God, amen. I believe that love is the motivation force behind everything God has ever done. If we can somehow or other take ourselves out of the just us and the failures and the mistakes and goodness knows what that we've done that says that that separates us from God, and instead of thinking that way, somehow or other see that God's love is so powerful that it dissolves everything we've ever done wrong. And somehow or other, through his eyes, he sees us as washed, as cleansed, as made whole and acceptable in his sight. You are acceptable in the sight of God today. And if we can come boldly before God's throne of grace and enter in, as even as around communion there, as Roman was saying, that to be able to stand in the presence of God in the Holy of Holies and not exempt yourself. You see, you are your own worst enemy. It's what you say about yourself that exempts us from coming into the presence of God. And you've got to understand, as much as I have to understand, that God's love is so powerful. It's so amazing. And love is the motivation force behind everything God has ever done, because God is love. He doesn't have love, God is love. It's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. And, you know, sometimes we think of repentance, it's not some shameful experience or an embarrassment in our lives. No, in reality, repentance is a way of escape. Love is the healing of every wound. The cross of Calvary is God's love poured out to every human failure. The cross of Calvary, if we can see that there, that God sent Jesus because of human failure, because of sin that had come in to the world, and that everything that had ever happened, the cross of Calvary really is God's love poured out to every human failure. Everything I've ever done wrong, whatever's happened, God made a way for me. Even in the animal kingdom, animals that have been abused respond to love. Every creature on this planet responds to love. I don't know about you, but I need love. Anybody else need some love around here? Come put up your hand and say, Lord, I need a bit of love. I can do with some love today, because love is the healing. Love does some amazing things. Love is the creative force in creation. When God created, everything was created out of love. Love really is a creative law. When God created the universe and he spoke into existence, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Everything he did, he had us on his mind. When he created all these things, we were the main motivation. We were on his mind. We were what he wanted to please. And at the end of each day, as the Bible goes through that creative week, at the end of each day, he said, and God saw that it was good. Everything that God created, he made sure that it was God. God saw that it was good. God saw it. He made sure of it. It was good for you and I to enjoy. He loves us that much. The word good, we use it in a very, very interesting way. Hey, Neil, is the steak okay? Yeah, it's good. But you see, in God's vocabulary or God's thinking, good is far more grandeur than anything you could ever imagine. Can you let your imagination sort of loose for a moment? What do you really think the Garden of Eden would have been like? Thorns and thistles and dried up junk fruit, smelly stuff. I would like to walk us through the Garden of Eden a little bit. Just walk us through. Can you smell the roses? Can you see the abundance of fruiting trees? Can you see the colors of the birds? Can you sense the atmosphere of God's presence? I would love to be more poetic to describe the beauty, the atmosphere, the grandeur of the place God prepared for you and I. You see, when God made it, he wanted to make sure it was good. He wanted to make sure that it was perfect. He wanted to make sure that his people, the one that he loved so much, his family would have a place that we could live in. Amen. God made sure it was good. Love is the language of the universe. Our redemption was birthed out of God's love for us. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his son a ransom for me. When man was created, the earth would have been filled with music, birds singing their songs. We often wake up to the songs because we live in Kawana Forest there. We often wake up to the songs of birds, the old magpie. What an amazing sound it makes. The butcher bird, I don't know, and I sit there and I whistle back at it and try to play the tune and sing the tune, but we listen to the tunes, the songs of these birds, and I've sat out there watching them. They're just sitting on their little perch, worshiping in a way, amen? You know, what would have heaven have really been like? What would have it, all these beautiful things happening? Flowers in abundance, the perfume would have filled the air, the atmosphere of God's presence as God welcomes man to planet Earth. He did all this because in his mind, he was going to create a man. He had everything prepared, all the beauty, all friend, please don't ever let the devil tell you are not loved. Don't let the enemy tell you you're a nobody or you're unworthy. God created it for man, for mankind. And he created all this beauty, all this fragrance, everything there as he welcomed man, as he fashioned man out of the dust of the earth, as he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And as this man became a living being, and as he spoke to Adam and as he spoke to him, he said, this is yours. I've done it for you. I've done it for you. Today, we can't see the stars so much. We can't see all that is in heaven, in the heavenlies, the atmospheres. We see some of the things there that come on the documentaries and that about the universes and everything that's out there. It's so amazing that God created it for our beauty, that we can lay on the sand and look up in the sky and see the stars and see all their beauty. What an amazing God we serve. Amen. God welcomed man to this planet. Satan's plan was to murder the love. He's doing so in marriages, families, man's relationship with his heavenly Father. One of the greatest horrible things that we can ever hear is when a man curses his God. When a man or a woman curses their or blasphemes their God, the one who loves them so much and gave his only son. I believe that love is the heart force of life. Love is what makes a home. Love gives us everything that is beautiful. When love dies, all that is beautiful dies with it. I've been around a long time now. I've watched young couples as they come in, as their infatuation with each other, their love for one another. 12 months later, 2 years later, 10 years later, whatever it might be, all of a sudden, love dies. And everything that was beautiful in that relationship dies with it. What a horrible thing. I believe that love gives. In John 15, 17, it says, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. But selfishness and greed has taken man away from God's dream. Selfishness and greed. I want you to have a look with me at 2 Timothy 3:1. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people turn away. You know, none of these things have taken God by surprise. He knows the heart of man. He knows where man is going. He knows what's going on, but he made a way. This morning, as we come into this house, we've come from all different thoughts and different thinkings, and we've got one that has just put her loved one to rest. So she's got her emotions. There's others that are going through different circumstances, different things. And we come into a building like this, and the music begins to play, and the presence of God, as he said he would, he said, I will inhabit the praises of my people. And all of a sudden, the presence of God just starts to fill the place. And, you know, the things in our mind all of a sudden melt away as we look full into his glory and grace. Friends, somehow or other, we, the church, have got to lay aside a lot of things to behold him. Last week, people touched by God as the healing presence of God comes in. Friend, God loves us. God loves us. Could you turn to somebody and say, God loves me? God loves me. God loves me. I had one time there in a church, I had this lady walk up to me. She wasn't looking very happy at me. She says, I love you, but I don't like you. And I thought, my God, how does that happen? And I went home wounded because she didn't really love me at all. And you know, on this planet, we can get hurt, but we've got to keep our eyes on him. Amen? Because he is the author and the finisher of our faith. And I believe that God is going to do in the church before he comes a work of grace that will cause us to live like he did. When he saw different circumstances, different situations, he allowed the love that God had poured out into his heart to rule and not his emotions. Amen. Who sinned? He that hasn't sinned cast the first stone. In the last days, men will be lovers of themselves. Self-centeredness has taken over the physical body and the human spirit. See, when man sinned, when Adam sinned, the physical body controlled mankind. He found he was naked. See, if your physical life is controlling you, all these things will keep bubbling up. Shame filled his life. Guilt filled him. Then he tried to cover his sin. When man was created, his spirit dominated him. But sin caused the physical body to be in control. When sin came, something happened. I often speak about when a human decides to follow Christ. And honestly and sincerely, I'm not talking about a Kellogg's cornflakes type of conversion. I'm talking about when a man or a woman honestly and sincerely wants Christ in their life. Who knows what I'm talking about? Not just something that we do because we're going to get a free cappuccino at the end of the meeting, but something because this is what we want to do. And we come out the front and usually you'll find the tears will be rolling down their faces and there'll be a heart there that's something's happening. And I've often said that we don't realize in the realm of the spirit what's happening. But we also can understand that when sin came into the world, the opposite happened. That somehow or other that which God wanted and God created had now willingly committed that unforgivable sin. And now his heart has changed and all of a sudden now self-centeredness and all this stuff comes into him and God is left on the side. What an amazing Savior we have, though. He had a plan. How many people are glad he had a plan? He had a plan. Sin caused the physical body to be in control. John 3, I'd like you to have a look at that with me as well. John chapter 3. And Jesus answered and said to him, chapter 3, verse 3, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, but that which is born of the Spirit is spirit." Then he said, "Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again." Out of this, what happened to humanity as the sin resulted in death, sin resulted in the human taking control. Now God says, "I want you to realize that I want you to be born again." You see, when you got born again, your spirit man came alive. When you got born again, something of the Spirit came in. That's why Jesus says, "Marvel not that I say to you, you must be born again." Born again of the Spirit. Romans 5:17, it says, "For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one Jesus Christ." Amen. Romans 8:6 says, "Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with Christ, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin and its effects." God's love brings us back to him. If we can realize that certain things happened to us at the fall and mankind was a result of that. We see the atrocities, we see the mess, we see the way things are going. But I want to tell you, there's only one thing that's going to change the tide of iniquity, and that's a move of God's Spirit. And that's the church coming into realization and understanding that God really loves us so much. That everything that God has ever done, He's done for you and me. He's created this beautiful atmosphere that we're in this morning. He wants us to come into it, but He also wants us to break free. I'm not no longer under the law of sin. I'm no longer under the law of guilt. I'm no longer under the law of shame. Yes, I've done things that are wrong. Yes, the enemy can come and accuse me. The accuser of the brethren can come. But friend, unless I understand that now I am a new creature, old things have passed away, that old man has been dealt with, things have been overcome now, I can triumph over things. We've got all these things. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. No weapon formed against me can prosper. I can't read the other two. But they're there, amen. There's something there that you and I have got to understand. Yes, I can understand my old sinful nature when self-centeredness and all that was in control. But now I've got to work with God. I've got to start to work with the Spirit of God. You see, you can be a Spirit-filled Holy Ghost man or a woman and still be controlled in your flesh if you do not know the truth. If you do not understand, if you do not realize what God has done for us. And what I'm sharing with you today is that somehow or other, we can build up an antidote when the enemy comes in, when temptation comes our way, and we can start to stand up and say, no, I'm a new creature in Christ. I have been born again. I've been filled with the Spirit of God. That old nature has been dealt with. That old thing, that old Adamic thing that was dealt right back there. Now I'm a new man. I've been filled with the Holy Spirit. And you see, what happens many times is if you don't fight, you lose. It's a time, I believe, for us to stand up against the waves of iniquity. We are being bombarded in the hour that you and I live in with so much rubbish, so much negatives. The church basically has been drawn away into so many different aspects, and we are not exempt from that. But I believe that God wants us to come back, bring us back into the heart of worship. The Bible speaks about God seeking people who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Friends, it's not a matter of singing half a dozen songs waiting for the late people to arrive. It's not a matter of just this is what we do, having a little bit of a pre-interlude before the service. Friend, I want us as a bunch of people to, from the very get-go, to get our hands in the air and our hearts open to God, to allow the presence of God to get all around our lives, to enter into His gates with thanksgiving in our hearts, to enter His courts with praise, to worship Him with everything that's on the inside of us. If I got to jump, if I got to get on a chair, I don't care what we got to do, but let's do it, amen. Let's not be offended by somebody that whistles louder or somebody that shouts. Let's be the shouters. Let's be the whistlers, amen. Let's make a noise. Let's be the clappers. Let's be the shouters. Let's be the people there that want God more than I want the favor of man. We want God, hallelujah, amen. How do you get God? Well, you get God by going after God, amen. Lifting up your hearts, lifting up your voices, seeking God, getting in the quiet place at home, opening up your Bibles, opening up and sitting there sometimes just saying, God, here I am. What can I do for you? God, here I am. What do you want me to do? You'd be amazed when God starts to download what He wants for your life. Amen. Because I believe that God is going to build a church. He's going to build a people of praise, a place there that God will fill with His love. Amen. If you need a healing in your body this morning, come out the front. We're going to anoint you with oil. We're going to believe God for you. We're going to anoint Chrissy's handkerchief and believe for her to take that to her friend, and she will get healed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come. Just come. Start to sing. Yep. Get ready. Oh, Jesus. If you're away from God today and you need to come back to Him, come back to God. Don't come back to just church. Come back to God. Come back to God. Come back to God. Come back to God. Come back to Him.